Okay, so I want to talk to you about WebAssembly because it's a technology that I've fallen in love with. I've been playing with Rust for a few years now, and when I saw that was one of the first platforms that supported this brand new thing that will be in all the browsers called WebAssembly. What the fuck is WebAssembly? I don't know. Let's find out. So, hello, I'm Jean-Franck Coupry. I work at Clever Cloud. We host your applications, and we take a look at every technology, every platform, every language available, so we can support it. So if you have anything to run, even Rust or Haskell applications, we can do that. Let's talk about WebAssembly. So there was this idea that people wanted to do stuff in the browser, and the only stuff they could do that with JavaScript. JavaScript is the main language for the front-end. And at some point, people realized that, yeah, but if we want to do like video editing, like every task that needs a bit of computing power, or, I don't know, crypto with number manipulations, JavaScript is not very well suited for that. And people have been experimenting, first with ASM.js, which was a subset of JavaScript that was much, much, much stricter and that could be compiled much easier by the browser to native code. So it was a nice experiment, and then from there people said, hey, but we could have a better platform for that. And they went into WebAssembly. Basically, one of the first use cases, like for SMGS and stuff, was, hey, I want to run a game in the browser, like a 3D game, like Unreal Tournament or that kind of thing. Because sometimes we want to run stuff on the web too. WebAssembly is meant to be like the common platform, the common compilation target for everything. It's a bytecode and a virtual machine that executes in your browser. So I guess you're familiar with Java, right? So that was one of the dreams of Java at some point, like you write once and it runs everywhere, because it compiles to a bytecode, so a list of instructions that can be executed by a virtual machine, and you only need to compile the virtual machine for your platform. The idea of WebAssembly is like, oh, I can take C++ or Rust or Haskell or Ruby or Python or whatever language and compile that to WebAssembly and it will run in the browser. It's a very, very small platform. WebAssembly cannot do much things. Like, there's no garbage collection, even if it's in talk to add that. There's no threading. It might come at some point. But it's when you write WebAssembly, it's like you're writing C. You're very, very low level. You do everything by hand. So that's why the first platform to do that, the first language supported was C and C++. But then Rust came and made that a bit more easier to use. It's designed to communicate with JavaScript. You load a WebAssembly file, it exports some functions, and the JavaScript can call a function. But the WebAssembly file can also say, oh, I want some functions from JavaScript that I can call, so they can communicate with each other. And we'll see you can do some fun stuff with that. And it's designed to be easy to compile. Like, you can take WebAssembly code and do JIT compilation, so compile to the native machine code for your CPU. You can do that. It's already done with JavaScript, but it's much, much, much easier with WebAssembly. So using it with C and C++ was not very accessible because the compilation was a bit hard to do. But in Rust, people have started to play with that. And like 6 months ago, it got very, very easy because we landed in the Rust compiler support for WebAssembly directly. So you could just take your file, it generates a WebAssembly file, and you put that on your website, and we'll be able to use that. So we'll see a bit how it works. This is the, can you see at the back? Yeah, is that okay? Okay, so this is the minimal example, just a small function that you send number to, and it will increment the number, and it will also call a log function. So at the top of the file, you see the external FN log. Basically, it's how you say in the WebAssembly part, I import that function from JavaScript. So JavaScript then has to give, where is it? Yeah, give in the environment a function that will be called and that will use the data. So for with this one, I should have updated the code. This one will give a pointer and I should have a length that as well. Pointer on the length, and the JavaScript can access the memory from the WebAssembly side and then get the string. It's very low level. It feels a bit like writing C code. Like, we're only manipulating integers, pointers, that kind of thing. On the JavaScript side, it feels like JavaScript. We have a function to get the WebAssembly file, to parse it, to get a module that we, on which we can then call functions. So the module will have like the add one function that we defined over there, and we can call that. To compile the Rust code, we have a Rust project, so we have first a compilation target for whatever assembly, and then a series of tools to make it much, much, much smaller. And so, when I click that, hello world. So it works. In that part of code, I had JavaScript code on the button that will that say, OK, now I want to call the add1 function from WebAssembly. The add1 function from WebAssembly called the log function in JavaScript to display this one. And then I display the result of the add1 function. So I go back and forth between JavaScript and WebAssembly. And the integration is mostly seamless. All right. So it's a bit raw at first. Like, we want to do front-end development. We don't want to write C-like code. But we can already like do interesting things. This is an example from people from Mozilla. They worked a bit on the source maps parser. Source maps are used when you have when you minify a JavaScript file or when you compile a TypeScript project to JavaScript. The source maps will take a look at the end file and will make the correspondence between the end code that's compiled that's used in the browser and the original code. So that's why you can have in your dev tools, you can see the TypeScript code or the CoffeeScript if you still use that, or the JavaScript code unminified. The thing is, the source maps parser, they were done in JavaScript at first. Like, there's an NPM module that's used a lot, like only like millions of times per month. The thing is, its performance is a bit all over the place. Like you see executed in Chrome, in Firefox, and in Safari. Those parts, that's where they rebuild that in Rust with WebAssembly. So they get better performance and much more reliable performance. Like almost always the same latency to parse a source map file. And then they took the WebAssembly file and integrated that in the node module. So you can ship node modules with WebAssembly that's been compiled from Rust code in real projects right now. And it was kind of easy to do. Like someone came afterwards and said, yeah, we can't get those numbers, this performance with JavaScript if we use that trick and that trick and that trick and we write the code that way and whatever. This performance, we got that with very naive Rust code very easily because it's very, very low level already. So we can do more interesting stuff. I said we don't have garbage collection, but like in C code, we can have allocators. So when you start a WebAssembly module, you will say, OK, it has this much memory, and the browser manages how many pages of memory the WebAssembly module will use. And on the WebAssembly side, we can allocate stuff, and there are the browser will be able to tell, OK, we need to allocate more memory or what. So I just take two functions to allocate and deallocate stuff. That's how it's written in Rust. The interesting part is this one. When we deallocate, we create a vector from a pointer and a length, and then we just do not use it, because it will be dropped right away. And Rust, we deallocate it. So this example is meant to take a string given from JavaScript, hash it with SHA-1, and then return the result to JavaScript to the JavaScript side. And so we export one function that takes a string, a C-like string that's terminated by a null char. We hash that. We allocate a new string, and we send that back to the JavaScript side, which will be able to deallocate it afterwards. So we're still pretty low level, because we have to manage the memory ourselves. But we can do already more easy stuff. The functions we have, like the alloc, dealloc, and digest, are exported by the module. So when I call my module, I create a new string. So it was a way to have a null terminated string. I call the exported function, digest. I get the result, and I copy that to a JavaScript string, and then I deallocate the one from the Rust side. And then I can display it. We are going always back and forth between JavaScript and Rust. This is where most of the issues can appear, because communicating between one and the other is quite expensive. WebAssembly is more meant to be like you have a huge calculation, you send that to the WebAssembly side, it runs, and then you get it later, but you don't do much calls. But we can still have stuff that's pretty fast and works quite well. SHA-1 is not the slowest thing we can have. But we can do, since we can have like text processing, maybe that's much funnier stuff we can do. And so a friend of mine started to work on a very, very, very cool project. You know that small PHP project called WordPress? So they have an internal text format to describe the blog post. And they had a JavaScript parser. So the tool's called Gutenberg. And he decided, OK, maybe I can write the parser in Rust with WebAssembly and see maybe it will be faster than the JavaScript one. And yes, it is. So the fastest example, like 108 times faster than JavaScript. Like one of the examples is just, parse the whole Moby Dick book. So we could ship that bit of Rust inside WordPress with WebAssembly. It's a platform that you can take almost any language and put that in the browser. It's a very, very significant thing. Imagine, for all these years, you had only JavaScript, and maybe some project that could compile to JavaScript. Now every language is rushing to support WebAssembly, because everybody will want to go and work on the front end from any language. We will see a very, very fun thing like, that will appear from that, like in the next few months or years. I showed like the raw example. Like if you want to do WebAssembly and you know a bit of C and you'll be at home with the kind of example I saw, but they're still a bit involved. So people started to write projects to make things much easier to manage. So WASM BindGen is an awesome little tool that takes your Rust code and say, okay, the Rust code imports an alert function that will work on a string, and it will export a greet function that takes a string and calls the alert function. This project will generate a JavaScript file that you can just import in your project. And then you'll be able to call your WebAssembly file as if it was nothing. But the goal is even much further than that. So you cannot read that because they don't make the document for readability. But basically, the idea is you could have your Rust code that compiles to WebAssembly. WASM BindGen generates the glue between the WebAssembly and the JavaScript. And then it can be packaged with NPM and used in Webpack and Bundler. Like, there's already a project where you put a Rust file in a project managed by Webpack, and it would just compile it and integrate it with the rest, and you do not have to think much about it. You can even have like WebAssembly file calling each other if they reference functions from one another. So it needs a bit of glue again, but the tooling is getting better and better and better. People have also worked on making the files smaller and optimizing them better. That's the WASM GC I showed just before. So the tool chain that's built mainly by Rust people right now, like this mainly, or maybe this, is specific to Rust. The rest of the tool chain, that will be maybe available for any language. And so very, very soon, you will see a lot of code that goes in the front end. We also have a nice project that's called STDWeb. The idea is when we communicate with the JavaScript, you saw that we're still importing functions, importing raw functions everywhere, and exporting functions that way. Maybe you can just, can we just execute JavaScript code from the Rust side? And we can. So this project, we just see, OK, we have this JS bang. After that, it needs, OK, it says, OK, that, this is JavaScript code. The JS export says, OK, this is a function that I want to expose to the JavaScript. And to go further, you can even do bindings to whole JavaScript API, like the DOM, WebGL. You can talk with the whole part, with whole parts of JavaScript right away. Could integrate that, I don't know, inside your Angular application. And this is available for Rust. This will be available for Ruby, Haskell, and whatever. So people have already started to build web frameworks on that. And I'm aware of, I think, one game that started to test with that. So STDWeb, it makes a small JavaScript file. And it exposes one global object. And you call that global object. And you get the module. And then it will run. I have a button there. Hello, Fox Days. With just the code we have there. So we just went a very long way from what we had just before. You see that WebAssembly is basically meant to offload tasks from JavaScript and communicate very easily. But we needed some tooling. We need some stuff that's more usable. What if we want to go a bit lower and do very, very nasty stuff? So this is the first thing that I was excited to do in WebAssembly like 6 months ago, like STD Web and Wasm-Bindgen did not exist. So I had to do all the stuff C style and say, hey, I want to mess with pictures. We have something that's called Canva in HTML. Maybe I can write pictures pixel by pixel and like transfer whole buffers of pictures, raw pictures from between JavaScript and WebAssembly. That will be very, very, very fast. So the first example was smaller than I thought. The idea is the JavaScript side will give me a pointer and a length that will be like the size that will be my image. And in a Canva, each pixel is 4 bytes, one for red, one for green, one for blue, and one for opacity. And so the first example is the first the red I put 255 and the opacity 255, and we just fill my buffer with that. Small example, I will just put one color everywhere. On the JavaScript side, this is where it gets a bit more involved, because you want to expose some part of the DOM that's very low level to the WebAssembly part. Turns out it's kind of doable. You get the Canva, you get the 2D context for the Canva, and then you allocate in your module. So I've hidden the alloc method, but it's the same I used in the previous example. I allocate a buffer, and I get a view of that buffer from the JavaScript side. And then I call my module and say, OK, this buffer, fill that with color. And then I put this color in my WebAssembly, in my Canva. So we need to copy data around. There was some way before to share buffers. Like you could have maybe shared the Canva one with the WebAssembly, but it was disabled for security reasons. So we have to copy data a bit around, and it can make the things a bit slow. But for this example, it's all right. We just have a red color, nice bright red. Not as red as on my screen. Well, okay, but that was maybe too easy. Maybe we can go a bit further again. So, request animation frame is a way for the browser to call code regularly, like anytime we must display something, anytime we must refresh the screen. This is mainly how people managed to do like smooth animations and that kind of thing. And the idea is maybe I can display stuff that moves and update my Canva again and again and again and again. And so it should be very, very easy to understand what I'm doing just from this code. No. I just make a whole bunch of squares, like 25 squares. And each has a base color, and they will oscillate between their color and black. And the whole color space will change. This is something I extracted from a demo that someone did for I don't know whichever constraint platform. And it runs OK. This runs at 60 FPS. And I'm still copying every pixel of the buffer at each frame. And it runs very nice. On the JavaScript side, we have the same code as before, but then we have this step function that's called by request animation frame. So at each frame that must be displayed, each time we refresh the screen, it will call that, verify if we progressed more than 15 milliseconds. If this much time has passed, we fill the buffer with the new data. So I pass the timestamp to the WASM file, and then I update the data. On the WASM side, I get the timestamp, and the timestamp is used for the base color up there and to move the color of the square. Can you imagine that from there we can do much funnier stuff, like we could do WebGL. I talked about STD Web before. Someone did an example of calling into WebGL, because this is a very raw way to display stuff, like updating pixel by pixel, color by color. Are we on Atari or what? See, so we can go much further, and we can do games. We can do much funnier stuff, but it shows we can have like fast code, nice stuff that runs, and the code is not that hard to write. Like, I would not want it to mess with stuff that oscillates, and I had to find a cosine function that was not very precise, but still fun to write. But you can mess with video stuff, so it's great. I had a lot of fun writing that code. Can we mess with audio stuff? So there's this nice API available in most browsers right now that's called Web Audio. It's meant to be a small synthesizer, so you can just create waveforms and send that to the speakers. You can import compressed data and decompress and play it. There's also something that's a bit close to what I did just before with the canvas. Is, hey, I could just get a buffer, put raw uncompressed audio in there, and send that to Web Audio, and maybe it will run. And so I take my very bad cosine function as before, and they create a waveform for which I take the... So I changed the frequency in example, but like the 440 is the A note. The rate is the, like, basically the number of values I will have per second, so like 44,100. Then a volume, and I just fill my buffer with the values. So I put that to have like an increasing volume, and then I have my signal that's a wave at one frequency, and I filled my buffer with that, and I give that to the JavaScript side. So this is just, again, a function from my module. I allocate a buffer, I have a view from the buffer on the JavaScript side, and then I call my module with the pointer. I could make a nicer API about that, but basically it's moving the buffers around. And I copy that in an array buffer that's been created for the Web Audio, and then I play it. So, will it work? This is where I have a very special move to show you, is how I support the audio with the mic. I have to get close to the laptop. Well, I guess you can hear already. Okay, this was very easy. Okay, but hacking on video, audio is always starting with a small thing, like I display one color, I will run one wave, and then I will hear that, and the sound is very crappy, but maybe there's better stuff we can do. And so I was hacking on that like 2 days ago, and this happened. So, if you've been in theater in the past like 20 years or something, you might have heard that this extremely loud jingle from THX. It was meant to show how awesome the sound they make. They had this jingle that would span so many frequencies and would be so loud that it was meant to impress. So I will just play it if I get. Oh yeah, I have the Wi-Fi. It's okay. You shall recognize that very, very easily.
You've heard that already.
This is so satisfying to hear. I still got chills. So, thing is, 3 weeks ago, as a joke, the people from THX, they released the score to play that thing. The score is quite simple, actually. It's that. So you have 30 voices at random pitches between 200 Hz and 400 Hz, and they will just move around slowly between frequencies. And then at some point, they get to that. And the thing is, at the time they made that sound, it was computer generated. It was like one of the first mainstream computer generated music that everybody had heard about. And it was completely random. Like, they are not really able to reproduce the exact sound they made, because it was generated at random. Like they tried a whole bunch of different ones, they recorded them, and then chose one that sounded nice. So maybe I can do that. I want to do that. And I started to play with that. So first, I have my wave function, something that gives me for a frequency and the rate and the timestamp, the value. So this is code I extracted from before. Another function that can give me, like, since each voice will change frequency here and there, a way to get the next one. So they can oscillate, get higher, lower. And I use a random number generator for that. And the signal function is the one I use to say, okay, from this timestamp to this timestamp, you will go from this frequency to this frequency. I take the previous signal with the base frequency, and I take the next frequency, the signal, and then basically there's a proportionality. Like if we're at the middle between the start, the timestamp to start changing and the timestamp to end changing, they'll be at the same level, but then they will oscillate one way or another. So I just adding two different waveforms, and then I can make larger things. So this is one voice that has its base frequency. All of this is Rust code, so it's kind of easier to write in Rust than C, but still most of the same. The period part is how fast they will change frequency, because I wanted to make that random as well. Like every voice will change at different times. And we get also an end frequency, so at which note of the end we will reach. There's still a bit of code. So the signal part will look at where we are at before. So are we still in the random phase, or are we now moving to the final note? And this is all of the frequencies from the final note. It's mostly A and D notes and one F sharp. And then the fill function generates the voices. It's always generated deterministically. My random number generator always use the same seed. You can try different seed to get different version of the sound. And so I don't even need to store state because the only thing that will change is the timestamp. And so maybe it will work. I will now do my special move. It's very creepy. This is not really the same sound. I have to try like a few thousand more. And there's the satisfying part. Once I had it working, I was just tweaking again and again. I could probably make a part of the, a page where I change the seed and I run it over and over and over and see what happens. So, WebAssembly is here to stay. It's a very cool platform. It's very cool to experiment, and it's not limited to the browser. People are starting to do very, very cool stuff with that. So it started to be used in cryptocurrency contracts. The Parity company is trying to push that right now. I've seen people trying to write kernels or kernel modules in WebAssembly. WebAssembly on the server, I will show you that like right away. But this is the idea I was thinking about. Can I get out of the full screen? Thank you. So you have this bytecode that's very small, very that's not limited to one platform. That's sandboxed, that's very well constrained. Maybe I could just do a serverless platform, a function as a service, where when you get the HTTP request, you just load the WebAssembly module, you execute the code, there's no operating system, there's no virtual machine or container or whatever, just load the module, allocate maybe a few pages of memory, get the response, and then you drop the module because you don't need to keep that in memory since it's so fast to load. And you could even git compile that afterwards. So I've been playing with the idea. And I got an example. So if you would check, so this is my serverless platform. If I look at my configuration file, will say, OK, I have this WebAssembly file. If you do get to slash hello and call the hello function, it will give a response. If you call the same WebAssembly file, but you on the slash bonjour prefix, and you call the bonjour function, you get another answer. If I take a look at my textfunc, SRC main, no. Wait. Ah, lib. Okay. So I have my hello function. I made a small library to expose, to have the virtual machine expose stuff like a log function and functions to set up the answer. So I want to set the status. I want to add a header. I want to add a body. And so if I do swaz, okay. I call hello, it answers hello world from WASM. And it just, afterward, just dropped the module. Don't need it anymore. The bonjour function will be the same one, the same thing, but in another language. Cool. Maybe you can go further than that. Hey, can we get backend TCP connections? Maybe to call a database or something? So I have another example. The test backend WASM file, it answers on the slash backend prefix. It, it, expose, it exposes the handle function, and then you have environment variables to say, okay, the backend is there. If I take a look at the code, so I will call my my host and say, okay, do I have the /env/backend key? If I have one, I connect to the backend code. And then I write hello there, and then I will get back the answer and put that in the body. It's not really interesting to just go through the code, just communicating. So if I call my backend, it's not connected. So I put on 8181. Okay. So now if I call, I received hello there. I can answer. Okay, it answered. And so before, between that, I could handle other requests. I can do that again. Oh yeah. Okay, so I was called over there. But I can do another request in the meantime. I get my answer. And then I get my answer over there. And it consumes almost no CPU, almost no RAM. Like a function, wasm function like that, will just get at most 4Ks of RAM, something like that. So I encourage you to go and have fun and test WebAssembly. You have lots of examples like the one I showed on hellorust.com, tutorials by the Rust WebAssembly working group, and WASM Weekly news shows awesome new examples or new tools you can do, you can use to play with WebAssembly. And there's the spec, and there are all of discussion to add more stuff in there. So it's very interesting to see. It's, I don't want to overstate it, but really it's the platform of the future. You will see that everywhere. You will not be able to ignore WebAssembly. It's there in your browser now. So thank you. And if you have any questions. Yes?
How does the performance compare to native? So, back in a few years ago, there was the mscript10 compiler that allows to compile, say, C or C++ into JavaScript, and there was a performance impact between JavaScript and native, like 5 or 6.
So the question is about the performance impact of WebAssembly compared to native. It depends if you can have like JIT compilation. It's designed to map very well to the underlying native code, but I think most JIT compilers right now do not have vectorization. So compared to like the C code that will be compiled directly by a C compiler, it will still be a bit slower. Compared to JavaScript, it's more interesting. It tends to run a bit faster than JavaScript already, since it's it's much faster to compile and parse. Like JavaScript, we spend a lot of time loading the file, parsing the file, and then compiling that. WebAssembly, it's very fast on that phase already. And then if you have JIT compilation, JavaScript is competitive since the virtual machines have been improved a lot. But WebAssembly is catching up on that part as well. But most of the time, WebAssembly is faster, yeah.
What kind of new file system operation in WebAssembly?
So the question is, how can I do file system operation with WebAssembly? You cannot, because it only has the API that's exposed by the calling code. So if the JavaScript say, okay, you can access that file, like maybe you're in a Node application, or you're in the serverless stuff, and then you expose a function to write to files, yeah, you'll have it. But it's a very, very small virtual machine. It's just you have memory there, you map the code there, and you tell the interpreter, okay, start there and execute. It's designed to be very small and very generalist. So the question about is what which VM I'm using for the serverless WASM is the it's WASMI. It's a WASM interpreter that's been created by the Parity company. I'm looking into integrating JIT compilation in that, but it's a bit complex still to do. But no, it's not V8. No. Yes. Is it possible to integrate WebAssembly in Node? Yes, it's doable, and you can. There are already NPM modules that contain some WebAssembly. Yep.
Do you have tools to debug WebAssembly in the browser?
So I think yes, we have tools to debug WebAssembly with source maps, but it's still a bit early for that kind of thing. Yeah, to manipulate the DOM, we need to call JavaScript functions. The DOM is not exposed yet to WebAssembly. There have been talks about that, but it's still not done. Okay, thank you for coming, and let's go have fun with WebAssembly.